So we have seen the last time this theorem of O'Grady, we are talking about APV 60 and double APV 60 to make a connection to Morin problem. And we saw the following theorem, so let me recall that. F O'Grady, saying that if I is a Lagrangian, some open subset, so this was the Lagrangian subspaces of lambda 3 C6 minus some divisor I'm going to talk about today. So if it is in this open subset, then we have that XA is smooth, where this XA was a double cover of EPV 60 that we introduced yesterday. So, and in fact, so in particular interesting for us is this what O'Grady called sigma, because the divisor sigma, so some remark. So sigma is a set of A Lagrangian such that A contains some decomposable tensor. So it contains a lambda 3 W in A, where W is a subspace of dimension 3 of C6. So this means that A contains decomposable tensor. And as soon as A is in this divisor, then the double cover is no more smooth, but it's singular in the PW that are then contained in YA. But this is important for Morin problem, so let's go to that. So I say I will not talk about delta, so we don't need that and take maybe too much time. So what is the Morin problem? So this is a very old problem in classical algebraic geometry, and it was formulated by Hugo Morin in 1930 in a paper sui sistemi di piani 2 a 2 incidenti. He studied the following problem. So classify configurations of planes. So planes, I mean then copies of P2 in Pn that are 2x2 incident. So classify means up to projective transformation. And the problem has in fact two aspects. So one can study family or configuration of planes that are finite and infinite. So two cases to consider. So we have one side, we have infinite configurations. And from the other side, we have finite configurations. But to correctly study the problem, one has to add some hypotheses on that. So if the configuration is infinite, one asks that it is irreducible and complete, where irreducible means as algebraic variety. So in his paper, Morin showed that such family can be seen as subvarieties of the Grassmannian, so are algebraic varieties. So you want it is reducible and complete. Complete means what is clear, so you can add more, you cannot add more planes. So if a plane cut all the other and it's contained in the family, then must be in the family. And so I will say something about that, But in fact, the case that is interesting for us is much more the finite configurations, because it's strictly related to this divisor sigma. And here you ask only complete. So complete means that you cannot add any plane anymore. Just one word on infinite configuration, because this was solved by Morin himself. So this paper is very, so like many papers of Italian mathematician in 1930, so all the proofs are very, very geometric. So typical Italian mathematics with plane, incident planes, linear systems, and so on. And this problem was solved, well, at least partially, much later, so by O'Grady in 2010. So some word about the result of Morin. So about one. So about one, there are in fact six possibilities. So three are elementary, as Morin calls. Any configurations. So these are planes of Pn to a point. So we have this way. And then you have planes of Pn cutting a given plane. In lines, so something like that. Cutting lines. And then planes of a P4. So these are the elementary configuration. And then if one excludes these three elementary configuration, Morin was showing that then the problem go back to P5. So one has to study configuration in P5. And he found three more configuration. Three non-elementary configurations in P5. Showing this in his paper that the problem go back to P5, and somehow it's funny because then P5 again will come out when we study the finite configurations. So the three one are the planes of conics of a Veronese. In P4, so these are, of course, the configuration that is contained in P5. And then tangent planes, always to a Veronese surface. To a Veronese surface. And then there are the family of planes. On a hyperquadric of P5. And one can show that, in fact, these are all complete family of planes, 2x2 incident. And what O'Grady did, so this was done in 1930, then nothing happened for a very long time, and then came O'Grady in 2010, that decided to study the second case, so about two, already in 2010. And first he showed that there are in fact two cases to consider. So you consider this configuration of plane in Pn, and then you can go back either to P6 or P5. And in P5, where happen most of the thing. So take T, so first T in Pn, complete family, finite complete family of planes. Always 2 by 2 incidents. And assume that first that n is strictly bigger than 5, then t is equivalent to a configuration of 7 planes in P6. And these 7 planes are in relation with the lines in the Fano planes. So it's how O'Grady constructs this example. And these are in relation, I will explain what I mean by this, with the lines in the Fano plane. The Fano plane, so let me write down the line. Well, first P2, F2. And the Fano plane, you have 7 lines. It looks like this. Oops. And on each side I have 3 vectors. So let me write down. So like, for example, like this. And just to make think about that, any plane, so generated by 3 vectors, and this point of the Fano plane correspond to the 3 vectors, and so that you see the incidence between the plane. So each plane is generated by 3 vectors. That can be identified with points on the lines. And so you see also the incidence between the plane. And so the question is not, well, it's interesting, but there is only one configuration when you go to Pn n bigger or equal than 6.
Is there a Hamiltonian interpretation of this?
Sorry?
Is there a Hamiltonian interpretation of this?
I had already the question, I don't know. I don't know, maybe, yeah, I don't know. So let me think, so go back to P5 and let's see what happened there. What can we say? And now EPV60 come into play there. So this problem is more complicated in P5. In P5, and so we have the connection to double EPV or EPV60. So what O'Grady do in this case? Maybe let's see first a proposition that make the connection to this family of planes. And this Lagrangian subspace is A. It's an easy one, so I will give you and then give you also the proof. Take always T in P5, complete family of planes. 2x2 incident, is what you want. And one can show that there is an a Lagrangian subspace in sigma such that T is exactly the set of decomposable tensors in A. So T is the set of PW such that W is a Ingrassmannian 3C6 and lambda 3W is in A. Yes, and just think 1 minute about the proof. So this is very, very easy. So this gives us a way to associate to any complete family of planes a Lagrangian subspace. So the proof is easy because take two planes, PW1, PW2 down in T, then they intersect. So this means that WT2 is not zero because they are incident. But then this means that lambda 3 W1 wedge lambda 3 W2 is equal to zero. So I take this volume form. And so I can consider B the set of all this, this W. So the span of lambda 3W such that PW is in T. So this is isotropic because of this remark. So this means that exist a Lagrangian such that A contains B, so something of maximal dimension. But then I know that the family T is complete, so this means that T must be equal to these spaces. T is complete. So this implies that T is equal to PW such that lambda 3W is in A. Otherwise, I could find more planes that are planes more that cut all the planes of T, and T would not be complete. So this is a way to pass from geometry, so complete family of planes in P5, and to these Lagrangian subspaces. So which is now the idea of O'Grady to give the bound? I will not give all the detail, but at least an idea. So O'Grady shows that the cardinality of T, so one first question before classifying all the configuration is to bound the cardinality like before. So we have seen the cardinality is 7 and it can only be 7. And O'Grady showed that this cardinality in this case, so in P5 is 20. And the idea to do that is just to fix a PW, so a plane in T, and consider the intersection of PW with this YA2. So remember that this YA2 is the singular locus of YA, and it is exactly when in the generic case where the double map ramifies on these singularities. And it shows that this is a sextic curve. For CBWA is a plane sextic curve. Which is singular. At the point PW prime, PW, where PW prime intersects this PW, we get a point of this curve, and then, this curve, the idea of O'Grady is then to study singularities of the curves. Singularities one can show that these points are contained here. So the points where two planes intersect are contained in YA2, inside the singularities of CWA. And study different the singularities, what he can bound, give this bound of 20. And what he does in this in his paper is then to construct examples to show which cardinality are possible.
So first, here you're assuming that T is finite.
Yes, yes, yes. Here is everything is finite here. Yeah. And so he gives also examples. For because you have the bound, but you don't know which well, it's not known which cardinality are possible. Example for k, let me call this cardinality of t with k between 10 and 16. And for to do that, he uses Kummer k3, or let's say more in general k3 quartic surfaces with k nodes. We start with Kartik surfaces with k nodes, so Kummer, for example, for k is equal to 16, and then it takes the Hilbert scheme of this quartic, or better, the Hilbert scheme of the resolution, and then actually the argument is by deformation, so it finds some special divisor on Hilb 2, or maybe from flop of this, and then it can deform to get then a configuration of planes. For this, there was already example of Dolgachev and Markuzevich. But the rest is new. And for a while, so the question was if the bound of 20 is a good bound. So there is an example. And in 2015, there was a paper of Van Gemen, I'm not putting maybe in the order, Kapuczka, Dontenburi, and Wisniewski, showing that this bound is possible. So there exists a with cardinality of t equal to 20. So just what do they use to construct this this set? Well, they start again with some special k3, so it seems to be the general idea to start with k3 that have special properties. So in this case are the one of the two Wimberg surfaces, k3 surfaces. And then again, they consider the Hilbert scheme, and then on this, they produce a concrete map to a hypersurface of degree 6 in P5 with a configuration of 20 planes. So here, everything is very explicit, so one can check also using some computer computation. But the question remains open, in particular for cardinality of T equal to 17, 18, and 19. Maybe smaller also, so I don't know. I think there are no results to say that these cardinality are possible. And also to classify them. So I think that one, Gregor Kapuczka, I think one of the two, they are showing that maybe the construction is unique, but of course it remains also the problem to study how unique are all these constructions. So this is what I wanted to say about Morin problems. So, and I will go now, since we are talking about two M-pole polarized EHS manifold, to some kind of other application and go back in particular to automorphisms. So special M-pole two polarized EHS and evolutions. So again, we stay with two unpolarized manifold as for APV. But now I will not no more consider the generic element in the family as APV sextic, but I will consider element with Picard number bigger. And moreover, I will study the following questions. So recall the following fact for K3. So take a generic K3 surface. Projective K3. So this means that the Nerón-Severi group of S is Z of H squared equal to T. So what can one say about the automorphism of S? So this is very well known. Well, if T is equal to 1, we have seen already several times in the lectures that we get K3 that are double planes, double cover of the planes. So out S is just Z modulo 2Z. And S is the double cover of P2 ramified on a sextic curve. But as soon as T becomes bigger, so I mean the generic case, then you have no more automorphism. So now one can take the Hilbert scheme of two points on S and ask a similar question. So in this case you have the, since I take S generic, so the smaller possible Picard number, which will be 2, and ask the same questions. Does it happen the same? So does it happen that for T equal to 1 I have this and otherwise nothing? Well, the answer is already no, we know already, because for T equal to 2 we know that we have a Bouville involution, and we will see that in fact there are many T for which we have involution. So let me write down. So what happened for S2? So what happened? So question, what happened for S2 when I have always this assumption of genericity? So the Nerón-Severi group of S2 will be generated by this Z8 plus Z delta, where this delta square is equal to minus 2. What we know already is that if T is equal to 1, well, out S2, I have here the involution iota, and this induces a natural automorphism. So this contains Z modulo 2Z generated by, let's say, iota 2, which is the natural involution. For T equal to 2, we know also that something happened. So even if our test is the identity, we have seen that in this case, so we have a quartic, Picard Nerón-Severi rank is 1, so it contains no lines. So we have that out S2 contains Z modulo 2Z, and this is generated by the Bouville involution. We don't know, a priori, for the moment, nothing when T is bigger or equal than 3. So I have the following theorem that answer actually the question completely. So the answer is the following theorem with some collaborators, Moisier, Cattaneo, Nipperwitz-Kirchen, and my myself in 2015. That. So we have always the same assumptions. I don't write it again anymore. And we show that here, in fact, we have equality. So if t is equal to 1, then we have that out S2, there is nothing more than the natural involution. And if t is bigger than 1, so there are some equivalent conditions to have an automorphism. And you will see that will come into play in Pell equation. So R equivalent. So first one, that out S2 is equal to Z modulo 2Z. Second one, that actually we have shown this equivalence already on Monday, that there is a delta, an n-pole class, n-pole divisor, with d squared equal to 2. So if you remember, we did it explicitly. And the third condition is the most important, because it's actually a purely numerical condition on t. So we have that t is not a square. The Pell equation pt minus 1, x squared minus t, y squared equal to minus 1, has a solution. And the n-pole cone of S2 is, let me write it this way, so S2 are lambda h minus mu delta, such that mu is positive and r mu is less than minus td lambda, where this a and b, let's say a minus b, minus b, so a is positive and minus b is positive, is the minimal positive solution of Pell equation pt1, which is x squared minus ty squared equal to 1. And this second condition, so this condition of the n-pole cone, was shown by Bayer and McCree, sorry, that this is equivalent again to another Pell equation, that the equation P4T5, which is equal to x squared minus 4ty squared equal to 5, has no solution. In the paper where they study stability condition, wall crossing, and movable and F cone. So this is condition interesting because, in fact, so we'll come back maybe later, tells you when do you have automorphism. Well, it's enough to verify some just numerical condition on T. So you need the T is not a square, this must be a solution, and this equation must not, don't have a solution. And so in this way, you just plug in this in a computer and tell you that there are in fact infinite number of t for which out S2 is not trivial. So one gets an infinite number of t such that out S2 is, well, not identity, equal to Z modulo 2Z. And so in the theorem we show, in fact, that we construct several involutions that are non-natural, because out S, when T is bigger than 1, has no automorphism. So in this way, one can produce a lot of involution that does not come from the K3. And there is one problem, maybe, I'm not sure I will have time to talk about, because the construction used Torelli, so it's not very geometric, like Bovill involution is very geometric. You see on the quartic, you have 2 points, you associate the 2 points, and it would be nice to realize this involution also geometrically. And for some t, we are able to realize it. Not really on S, one has just to deform a little bit S and then on S2, but one can see the involution appearing, and it turns out that it's a composition of Bovill involutions. So maybe let me say some word on the proof. How can one find the Pell equation? Well, first maybe one remark on T equal to 1. Okay, let me start here. Let me start it here. So about the proof. So for t equal to 1, one won't not think anymore about that. One can show that if such an involution exists, let's say f, then the action of f on NS S2, one can show it's the identity. There is only this possibility. And then, since we have seen this theorem at the beginning, since then F star preserves the exceptional set, then must be natural. So one can show that there is some work to do here. Then, since F star of E is equal to E, so recall that E is equal to delta, then F star must be natural. Maybe F even. And so F is equal to this natural involution. So let's go to the case that is more interesting, when T is bigger than 1. And let us think about how one can find the Pell equations. So assume bigger than 1, and how to find the Pell equation? Well, one first Pell equation comes from the isometry of the Neron-Severi group. So if you have that, you have, well, if you have F in out S2, then F induces an isometry of NS. NSS that I write by using the bilinear form, which is 2t, 0, 0, minus 2. And one can compute that the isometry are of the form A, B, two kinds of matrices that one can obtain, T, B, A, or A, B, minus T, B, minus A, and A square minus T, B square is equal to 1. So you see already coming some Pell equation. And but we know also that we have such an automorphism, then it must preserve the Keller cone. So one starts studying n-pole classes. So there are, for example, result of Knudsen that allows to find n-pole classes on S2, for example. And one sees that, in fact, this cannot happen. So since F star on NS, NSS2. Is effective, so it preserves ample classes. One shows that an ample class in ample classes. only the second possibility happen. And we find that in this case, we have so we have these matrices, AB minus CB minus A, and we have that A is positive, minus B is positive, A squared minus TB squared is equal to 1. So we find here the Pell equation PT1. And in this case, one can also determine the ample cone, as in the statement. And this is the result of Bayer-McCree, that says that this A and minus B are the minimal positive solution of Pell equation. One can determine also the ample cone, AS2, let's say as in the statement, so I will not write it again, it's still there. And again, Bayer-McCree say that A minus B is a minimal positive solution of PT1. So we see this happen, appearing the ample cone and this minimal possible solution. In particular, what does this say? That remark. So if such an involution exists, then it determines the ample cone, because I can write down the matrix. And vice versa. I have the ample cone, and then I have, if the involution exists, I have I can determine the action of the involutions. We know, well, I'm talking about all the time about involution, so but I have to precise this. Of course, so the square of this matrix, so F star square, is the square of this matrix, so it is the identity. And again, using always the same result that we use a bit all the time, so we know that this is identity on NS S2. And as there, so this means that F star square preserves the class of E. So F is natural. F square, sorry, is natural. So this means that F square is identity, because we are in the hypothesis of T bigger than 1, and so there are not automorphisms. So this, we are really expecting only involution, and moreover, non-symplectic involution. So the fact that are non-symplectic involution follows from the fact that, follow from the result, actually, of Mongardi and Camere, that, so F, we expect only non-symplectic involution, because if F would be symplectic, then there is a result of Mongardi-Camere, saying that the narrow severity group is then would be of bigger rank, so the rank of NS S2 is at least 8. So we expect only non-symplectic involution, and if such an evolution exists, so we have all these conditions. So I will just say one word about the second Pell equation, and then I will stop. So the second Pell equation pt minus 1, so x squared minus t y squared equal minus 1, comes from the existence of D in NS S2, which I recall you equals ZH plus Z delta, with D square equal 2. If you remember, again, so we have all these, actually these are all, so if I have an involution, I have all these conditions, and I know that because, well, I was showing that 2 days ago, that I have this ample class with square 2, and if you write this in this set of generators, this is really equivalent to say that pt minus 1, or at least implies for the moment, that pt minus 1 has solution. Okay, so in this way, somehow these are main ingredients to show that from 1 I can get 2 and 3, and then if you want to go back, well, from 3 you show that inside the ample cone you have an ample class like this, and then you go back with the theorem we showed last time. So I have no time, unfortunately, to tell about geometric realizations. So geometric realization we have only for, just a last remark, so geometric realization of the evolution for the t that satisfies the theorem. Of the form t equal to alpha plus 1 square plus 1, and also with alpha even. So this was based on an idea of Markusevich, so it's a work in progress with Boissière, Cattaneo and Markusevich, that one deform a little bit the K3, then one can find different embedding of the K3 in projective space in P3 as quartic. One can find there a Boolean involution, and then find the involution on our surface S of Picard 1. So it is just a composition of three Boolean involutions. Okay, I will stop here.
No.
You expect to get a rational variety, for example, or something?
Maybe, yeah. So one for the Boolean evolution, one should know, but maybe rational, maybe something like that. But it's also a big problem, is well, the quotient by the evolution, but also studying the linear system induced by this D ample. For the K3, it gives this 2 to 1 map to the to P2, and but here is not clear. So we can have base points, or very few is known about this kind of divisor.